I believe that routines are very important. It's kind of like the foundation. People should just realize that there is a lot of things in life that are difficult. And you have to ask yourself the question right off the top, are you going to be one of those guys that are going to go and back off every time something is difficult? Or do you want to be one of those guys that says, look, it doesn't matter if it's easy or difficult or most difficult, I'm going to go and crush through it. That's me. That's the person that I want to be, and I'm going to prove it to myself, and I'm going to prove it to the rest of the world. It's difficult for people to have a routine, but they just have to go and do that, and they should just work on it. But they go and say, do something very simple. I'm going to go and get up every morning at, let's say, an hour early, and just work on that. And then the next time they work on it, they say, okay, I'm going to get up early, and I'm going to go and make my coffee or my tea or whatever, and I'm going to read papers, even though maybe I haven't read the paper yet in the last 10 years. That's the key thing about the routine, is that you don't ask yourself, should I or shouldn't I? You just do it. Time doesn't mean anything, and we found out that the body is as receptive at 3 in the morning as it is at 3 in the afternoon, or as it is at 9 in the morning, or at 5:30 in the morning. It makes no difference. You just have to get over these barriers where you say, oh, I can never do this in the morning or something like that. Just do it. And this is where the advantage comes in, is if you do it automatically, where you say, this is my goal, and I'm going to challenge myself and do that. I'm doing this automatically. You can make the decision. There's certain things that you should do. The amount of things that you want to build on that you do automatically should get bigger and bigger and bigger. And then there are moments where we have to get very creative. And then we really have to sit down and think and have brainstorming sessions and really get those brain cells going, where you have to make major decisions. That's when you use your creativity. That's when you can sit down and be creative and think about those things. But the rest of it, you just do.
The best things in life takes time. When I was younger, I was impatient because I had the naivety of thinking that dreams would come quickly. But the best things in life take time. From simple things like food, preparation, to more complicated issues of parenting and marriage, the best things in life take time. It is a sharp contrast between being rich and being wealthy. You can hit the lottery, receive an inheritance. You can be catapulted from rags to riches, and you can be rich quick. Though many define wealth differently than how I will today, true wealth isn't just about money, but it is about the lessons you learn while struggling upward. If you have money without wisdom, you will soon be parted from your money. The best things in life take time, takes relationships. You got the money, but because it was given to you quickly, you didn't build the infrastructure to sustain it. You don't have the relationships to sustain it. You don't have the information to sustain it. And most people who hit the lottery, 70 to 80% of them go broke within 5 years. You can't imagine that you could hit that much money and lose it, but the truth of the matter is, God is teaching us that the best things in life take time. You learn from struggling. There are things that you learn from tests and trials and trial and error. Some of my best teachers were failure. It takes time to do well. It takes even longer to be well. Some people are seasonal. Some relationships are seasonal. Some opportunities are seasonal. And yet when we see the seasons change, we think the blessing has ceased. But it is not that the blessing has ceased. It is that the season has changed. There is a time to be born, and there is a time to die.
This person was not made by God. I made this person. I made this person by diving into the insecurities that life gave me. Because now they're yours. They're yours to own. If you're not smart, call yourself dumb. It's okay, because you are. But take that now as you're putting yourself down. If you're fat, call yourself fat. I used to be 300 pounds. We want to talk so soft to ourselves. We're looking for that recovery day. And that recovery day is everything in your life. Everything in your life is a recovery day. We're looking for it. It's not coming. It's not coming. Get over that recovery day. And that's the mentality I took with me. And what happened through that process was all the frivolous things of life started to float away. I used to tell people lies so they would like me because I was so insecure. When you start to build yourself up and start to have the one thing that we don't have is confidence. Real, authentic confidence from hard work. Everything else goes away. You no longer look to other people for your self-esteem.
For validation.
That's right.
For, yeah.
You now know. I walk in the room now and I know the hours and years and decades I put into David Goggins. It's not on the wall. It's not a trophy on the wall. It's not a medal around your neck. It is actually a feeling in your heart. And people go, why don't you ever smile? I don't have to. I do have a stoic look on my face. I'm a very focused person. But the feeling I have in my soul and in my heart, that's why I need to smile. I don't need to smile. I don't need you to look at me and say, oh my God, you look happy. Because half of us aren't happy. We're giving you something that we think you want to see. I don't do that anymore. I don't care how you perceive David Goggins, because through my journey, I figured out the one piece I was missing. I thought it was cars. I thought it was women. I thought it was money. I thought it was everything. The one piece I was missing was me having the courage to face myself. Where I got my work ethic from was the hours I had to spend learning this. When you sit down and you're not smart and you still want to be in the top of your class, I didn't want to just get by. When I realized that I can learn through hard work and I can beat the valedictorian of school, but I got put in 10 hours more a day than he does. You know what kind of strength comes from that? When you're sitting down, that guy that valedictorian studied for an hour, and you know I caught you. I caught you, and I am dumb. But I have the work ethic to catch you. That's where David Goggins got really invented, was at a kitchen table with 20 spiral notebooks that were empty. And then 3 months later, they were full. And when you can go through that, I still have them in my storage unit. You go through these spiral notebooks of your life and you realize, this is how I learned. This is unbelievable. There's no miles. It's not about the miles. It's that, having a discipline every day to say, for me to learn this one math problem, it's gonna take me 10 hours. And you realize through hard work, you can outwork anybody.
It's understandable if you're a little nervous. Every single one of you has something that you're good at. Every single one of you has something to offer. And you have a responsibility to yourself to discover what that is. There is no excuse for not trying. Where you are right now doesn't have to determine where you'll end up. No one's written your destiny for you, because you write your own destiny. You make your own future. Whatever you resolve to do, I want you to commit to it. I want you to really work at it. I know that sometimes you get that sense from TV that you can be rich and successful without any hard work. That your ticket to success is through rapping or basketball or being a reality TV star. Chances are you're not going to be any of those things. The truth is, being successful is hard. You won't necessarily succeed at everything the first time you try. That's okay. Some of the most successful people in the world are the ones who've had the most failures. Michael Jordan was cut from his high school basketball team. He lost hundreds of games and missed thousands of shots during his career. But he once said, "I have failed over and over and over again in my life, and that's why I succeed." These people succeeded because they understood that you can't let your failures define you. You have to let your failures teach you. You have to let them show you what to do differently the next time. No one's born being good at all things. You become good at things through hard work. You're not a varsity athlete the first time you play a new sport. You don't hit every note the first time you sing a song. You've got to practice. Don't be afraid to ask questions. Don't be afraid to ask for help when you need it. I do that every day. Asking for help isn't a sign of weakness, it's a sign of strength, because it shows you have the courage to admit when you don't know something, and that then allows you to learn something new. And even when you're struggling, even when you're discouraged, and you feel like other people have given up on you, don't ever give up on yourself. So today, I want to ask all of you, what's your contribution going to be? What problems are you going to solve? What discoveries will you make? I expect you to put your best effort into everything you do.
Every night, I hear the voices. You won't come out of this. You're not smart enough. You're not bright enough. You waited too late. You should have started younger. Those are the kind of voices that we all live with. Those voices are the kind of voices that stop you from buying into your own life. Stop you from enjoying the good times and believing that they will last. The anxiety and the pressure and the strength that it took to get from where you were to where you are doesn't go away, so you don't really believe it's yours. You're driving it, but you don't really believe it's yours. And you're scared to relax and really rest in whatever it is or whoever it is, because everything else went away. We talk about faith for bad times, but you also need faith in good times. To actually believe the goodness of God is not going anywhere. To silence the voices that keep saying you'll never make it, you're about to lose everything. Fear gets in your heart. I know what it's like to be poor. And I know what it's like not to have dinner for my kids. Returning to that, the idea that that could happen, is terrifying. And the enemy always has some sort of tool or memory or situation that he uses to terrify you, even though the good times are here. And the dream is there, and the blessing is there, and the goodness is there. But there's always this haunting, nagging defiance that says, "Don't you relax. You're not worth it. You don't deserve it. And it's not going to last." You are what you eat, and the voices are the food that feeds your faith or fear. So if you want to change your diet, you can change your outcome. But you have to stop talking to yourself the way you do. Because if you continue to talk to yourself the way you do, you will always be where you've always been. It is what you say within yourself that heals you. It takes word to combat word. "I got this, I can handle it, I can do it, bring it on, here it is." That kind of talk, saying that to yourself, drives back the other voices of negativity that we all have creep up behind us and tell us that we're not capable and we're not competent and we're not gifted enough and we're not good enough. Talk back to those voices, shuts the enemy down. There are things echoing in your head right now that are stopping you from living your best life, because you will not silence them by speaking back.
You shall have whatever you say.
When you want to succeed as bad as you want to breathe, then you'll be successful. If you ever had an asthma attack before, you short of breath, the only thing you're trying to do is get some air. You don't care about no basketball game. You don't care what's on TV. You don't care about nobody calling you. You don't care about a party. The only thing you care about when you're trying to breathe is to get some fresh air. That's it. And when you get to the point where all you want to do is be successful as bad as you want to breathe, then you'll be successful. Most of you won't be successful because when you're studying and you get tired, you quit. Don't cry to give up, cry to keep going. Don't cry to quit. You already in pain, you already hurt, get a reward from it. The most important thing is this, to be able at any moment to sacrifice what you are for what you will become. You quit and you ain't even tried yet. Pain is temporary. It may last for a minute, or an hour, or a day, or even a year. But eventually, it will subside. And something else will take its place. If I quit, however, it will last forever. I was homeless for 2.5 years. And the problem with most of you, you never felt no pain before. Y'all spoiled. Your parents have done everything for you. You never had to do nothing for yourself. You're spoiled. Some of you are spoiled brats. Every time you ever got in trouble, somebody in your house got you out of it. People say, Eric, your mother's a tyrant. You're right. She kicked me out. You're right. She's mean, but she developed a man. Because she put me out there and said, you're going to have to grow up. And some of you have never learned to grow up. And so every time something get hard, you quit, you call mama. I dare you to take a little pain. But I'm exactly where I wanted to be. Because I realized I gotta commit my very being to this thing. I gotta breathe it, I gotta eat it, I gotta sleep it. And until you get there, you'll never be successful in life. But once you get there, I guarantee you, the world is yours. So work hard and you can have whatever it is you want.
Don't worry about the fact that you don't have all the things you need in order to make it happen. Decide that you're gonna do something about it. Become an active force in your life. See, you've got some talents and abilities right now you have that if you don't challenge yourself to use those talents and abilities, you'll never ever discover the full effect that they can have on achieving all the things that you want to achieve. Most people go through life never using the power they have. You have enormous power to begin to create all the things that you want in your life experience that most people go through life never using. If you don't use your talents, if you don't use this power, this force that you have within you, you're going to lose it. If you have the ability to write, and if you don't write, you're going to lose the ability to write as well as you do right now. If you have the ability to play an instrument, the world's greatest said that if I miss a week of practice, I know it. And if I miss 2 weeks, the critics know it. And if I miss 3 weeks, my audience knows it. If you have the ability to draw well, and if you don't use that talent eventually, you're going to lose it. So whatever you want to do, whatever idea that you have, the longer that you're sitting on that idea, you're either creating or you are disintegrating. If you're not using it, your skills are diminishing every day. And there goes a second. There goes another second. And life is happening right now.
get your butt out of the way. So many people have gone to their graves, never discovered their true potentials because they allow their butts to stop them. Answer your calling. Don't count yourself out. Don't say, I can't do that. Many of us go through life saying no, and you don't even know what you're saying no to. You don't know what you cannot do if you're not willing to challenge yourself. Whatever it is that you don't know how to do right now, you can learn. If you do your research, if you do your homework, if you make the commitment that I'm going to learn, when you look at what do I have going for me and drop your buckets where you are, decide I'm going to work and get myself together. A guy named Jim Rohn said, if you develop your gifts will take you places that you'll never begin to imagine. Just find one thing and just decide that you're going to work with it until it gives you the blessing that you want, and don't let up on it. Just keep right on working it and working it and working it, and knowing that whatever you do, you can better your best, that you can get better at it, that whatever you are achieving right now, it's only a tip of the iceberg of what's possible for you. The major key to your taking charge of your destiny is you. It's you.
Discipline, it does start with waking up early. But that is just the beginning.
I've never met a person who was not successful that didn't have a great amount of self-discipline within their life. Self-discipline and being able to perform and being able to keep your life on schedule and being able to keep commitments and promises and meet deadlines is essential to success. None of us can afford to have a life that is controlled by someone else, or a life that is basically controlled by our emotions.
The thing about self-discipline is that it is necessary for everything you do in your life. You have to be self-disciplined. If discipline comes from somewhere else, it's very, very hard to remain consistent because you tend to resist. Discipline is not punishment. Discipline is training. If you change your mindset and really focus it on what discipline really is, you start to welcome discipline. You welcome self-discipline into your life.
Self-discipline is essential in your life and in my life if we're going to get things done.
Discipline is the root of all good qualities. It's everything. It's working out every day, making yourself stronger and faster and more flexible and healthier. It's about disciplining your emotions so you can make good decisions. It's about having the discipline to control your ego so your ego doesn't get out of hand and control you. Discipline means taking the hard road, the uphill road, to do what's right for yourself and for other people. The discipline calls for strength and fortitude and will. Discipline is your best friend. It will take care of you like nothing else can. And will put you on that path, the path to strength and health and intelligence and happiness. And most importantly, it'll put you on that path to freedom.
I scored not a free throw, not a nothing, not a lucky shot, not a breakaway layup, 0 points. And I remember crying about it, being upset about it. My father just gave me a hug and said, listen, whether you score zero or score 60, I'm going to love you no matter what.
Wow.
Now that is the most important thing that you can say to a child. Because from there, I was like, okay, that gives me all the confidence in the world to fail.
Tell me what that statement meant to you at that time, and how did it actually motivate you to continue scoring 60 rather than go, oh, I'm all right at zero?
Well, it did more than that, right? So, like, the basketball stuff speaks for itself in terms of what that comment did for me, in terms of giving me stability and giving me confidence to say, okay, it's okay to fail because you're going to be loved no matter what. And that doesn't just mean basketball. It means anything in life. It means writing. It means being an entrepreneur. It means having the confidence to go for it. I've seen too many parents do the exact opposite, and it terrifies children, and children become paralyzed by their own fear because they don't have that security blanket of love and comfort. You know, what I try to do is just try to be still and understand that things come and go, emotions come and go. The important thing is to accept them all, to embrace them all, and then you can choose to do with them what you want versus being controlled by emotion. You know, a lot of times I've seen players, even myself, and you know, when I was younger, being consumed by a particular fear, and to the point where you're saying, okay, nah, it's not good to feel fear. I shouldn't be nervous in the situation. And it does nothing but grow versus stepping back and saying, yeah, I am nervous about the situation. Yeah, I am fearful about the situation. Well, what am I afraid of? And then you kind of unpack it. And then it gives you the ability to look at it for really what it is, which is nothing more than your imagination running its course, you know? You think about game-winning shots or game-winning free throws, and people go to the free throw line and they're nervous about it. Well, what are you really nervous about? If you unpack that, okay, you're nervous that you're gonna miss the shot. All right, so you miss the shot, then what happens? People are gonna be embarrassed. You're gonna be embarrassed because thousands of people, millions of people see you miss the shot. All right, and then what? People are gonna talk bad about you. So you're looking at it and go, are those things even important? That is my fear. Like, what is, you worried about letting your teammates down? Okay, have you let them down before? Well, I'm sure, in practice and things of that nature, right? They're still there. And so when you're able to unpack it, you kind of look at it for what it is, which is really nothing. Don't hide from it. You know, you got to be able to look at it and deal with it head on.
You've lived a life dominated by doubt and fear. How do you step into bravery? Step. That's how you step into bravery. Step. Take the step. Step aggressively towards your fear. And that step towards your fear is the step into bravery. Because we're scared of what we don't know. And there is only one way to learn and to know, and that is to confront that fear. You have to step, you have to go. And this simple action, this simple attitude, it answers so many questions. So many questions. How do you get to the gym every day? You step, you go. How do you change your diet? You step, you go. How do you overcome fear of failure or fear of success or fear of fear itself? You step. And how do you face the fear of the unknown? You step. Don't wait anymore. Don't think anymore. Don't plan anymore. Don't contemplate anymore. Don't make any more excuses or justifications. Don't rationalize anything else. No, no, and no. Instead, be aggressive. Take action now. And what is the first action that you need to take? What's the first step you need to take? The first step you need to take is just that. Step.